You're best to call this journaling, man by man, according to the script.
Here is a scroll of everyone's name that is thought fit through all of Athens to play in our interlude before the Duke and the Duchess on their wedding day at night.
First, good quince, read what the play treats on, and then read the names of the actors, and so grow to a point.
Marry our plays, the most lamentable of comedies, the most cruel death of Pyramus and Thisbe.
A very good piece of work, I assure you, and a merry. Now, good quince, call forth your actors by scroll. Masters, spread yourselves.
Answer as I call you. Nick Bottom, the weaver.
Ready. Name a part and work and proceed.
You, Nick Bottom, are set down for Pyramus.
What is Pyramus? A lover or a tyrant?
A lover that kills himself most gallant for love.
That, I will ask some true tears in the performing of it, if I do it. Let the audience look to their eyes. I will move storms. I will condole in some measure. Yet, my chief humor is for a tyrant. The raging rocks, the shivering shocks, shall break the locks of prison's gate. Amphibious cars shall shine from afar and make him mar the foolish fates. This was law.
Francis Flute, the bellows window.
Here, Peter Quince.
Flute, you are set down for Thisbe.
What is Thisbe, a wandering knight?
No, it is the lady that Pyramus must love.
Wait, let me not play a woman. I have a beard. Coming.
Oh, and I might hang my face. Let me play Thisbe too.
I'll speak in monstrous little voice.
Listen, listen. Ah, you miss love.
And my lady, Thisbe.
No, no. You must play Pyramus. In flute, you Thisbe.
Well, proceed.
Robin Starveling.
Here, Quince.
You must play Thisbe's mother. Snout, the tinker.
Here, Quince.
You, Pyramus's father.
Myself,
Thisbe's father.
And Snug, the joiner. You are the lion's part, and here, I hope, is a play fitted.
Have you the lion's part written? Pray you, if it be, give it to me, for I'm slow of setting.
You may do it extempore, for it is nothing but roaring.
And I'm a bit of lion, too. I will roar. Then I'll make the Duke say, let's him roar again. Let's him roar again.
No, no. You must play Pyramus.
Well, Pyramus is a sweet-faced man, a proper man, a man you might see on a summer's day. So therefore, you must need play Pyramus.
Well, I will undertake it.
Masters, here are your points. I am to entreat you to meet me in the forest, a mile without town. There we will rehearse at midnight.
There we will meet, and there we rehearse most obscenely and courageously. Take pains, be perfect. Adieu.
Fairy kingdom. Fairies, away.
Well, go thy way.
this grove till I atone with thee for this injury. My gentle pup, come hither. I saw Cupid all armed. A certain aim he took at a fair vessel thrown by the west, and loosed his love shaft smartly from his bow. Marked I where the bolts of Cupid fell, and it fell upon little Western flower, before milk white, now purple with love's wound. Fetch me that flower, the juice of it, on sleeping eyelids laid, will make man or woman madly dote upon the next living creature that it sees. Fetch me the serve.
I'll put a girdle round about the earth in
40 minutes. Having once this juice, I will watch Titania while she's asleep, and drop the liquor of it in her eyes. The next thing she then wakes and looks upon, be it on bear, on wolf, on lion or bull, on meddling monkey, or on busy ape, she shall pursue it with the soul of love. But who comes here? I am invisible, and I will overhear their conference.
I love thee not, therefore pursue me not. Where is her Lysander and Hermia? The one I slay, the other slay me. You told me they were here in this wood, and here I am, woe to the wood, because I cannot find my Hermia. Hence, get thee gone, and follow me no more.
You draw me, hard-hearted amendment.
Why entice you? Do I speak you fair? Or rather, in plainest truth, though I not say, I cannot, nor do not love you.
And even for that, do I love you the more. I am your spaniel. Spurn me, strike me, neglect me, lose me, only give me leave, unworthy as I am of loving you.
Tip not the hatred of my spirit, for I'm sick when I love you.
And I'm sick when I would not love you. Cannot fight for love as men may do. We should be wood and not be made to woo. I'll follow thee and make a heather pell to die upon the hand I love so well.
Fare thee well, then, ere he do leave this grove. Thou shalt fly him, and he shall seek thy love. Hast thou the flower there? Welcome, wanderer.
Hey, here it is.
I pray thee, give it. I know a bank where sleeps Titania sometime of the night. Lulled in these flowers, with dances and delight. And with this, I'll streak her eyes, and make her full of hateful fantasies. Take thee some of it, and seek through this grove. A sweet Athenian lady is in love with a disdainful youth. Anoint his eyes, but do it, so the next thing he espies may be the lady. Thou shalt know the man by the Athenian garments he has on.
Fear not, my lord, your servant shall do so.
Rest my head.
One turf shall serve as pillow for us both, one heart, one bed, two bosoms and one troth.
Good night, sweet friend, thy love near altar, no less be like it.
Here is my bed, sleep give thee all of its rest.
Through the forest have I gone, but Athenia found I not. Night in silence, who is here? Athens he doth wear. This is he, my master said. Despise the Athenian maid.
And the maiden, sleeping sound, on the dank and dirty ground.
True upon the eyes I throw, all the power this charm doth owe.
Stay though thou kill me, sweet Demetrius.
I charge thee hence, do not haunt with us.
Oh, I'm out of breath in this fawn chase. The more my prayer, the lesser is my grace. Happy is Hermia, wheresoever she lies, for she hath blessed and attractive eyes. How come her eyes so bright? Not with salt tears. If so, my eyes are oftener washed than hers, but who's this? Lysander? On the ground? Dead? Or asleep? I see no blood, no moon. Lysander, if you live, good sir, awake!
Oh, Helen! Run through fire, I go, for thy sweet sake. Where is Demetrius? Oh, how fit a word is that vile name to perish upon my sword.
Do not say so, Lysander. Say not so. What though he lack her Hermia? Lord, what though? Yet Hermia still loves you, and be content.
Content with Hermia? Oh, I do repent. The tedious minutes I with her have spent. Not Hermia, but Helen I love. Who will not exchange a raven for a dove? Reason becomes the marshal to my will, and leads me to your eyes, where I overlook love's stories written in love's richest book.
Wherefore was I to this keen mockery born? When at your hands did I deserve this scorn? It's not enough, young man, that I did never, no, nor never can, deserve a sweet look from Demetrius' eye. That you must call my insufficiency? Perforce, I must confess, I thought you were a lord of more true gentleness.
Prefor, she sees not Hermia. Hermia sleep thou there, and never mayest thou come Lysander. And all my powers address your love and might to honor Helen, to be her knight.
Help me, Lysander, help me. Do thy best to pluck this crawling serpent from my breast. Aye, me, for what a dream was here. Look how I do quake with fear. Methought a serpent ate my heart away, and you sat there smiling in this cruel grave. Lysander, what removed? Lysander, Lord, out of hearing, gone? Lysander, speak. And if you hear, I swoon almost with fear.
How are we all met?
Pat, pat, what a marvelous convenient place for our rehearsal.
Quince.
What sayest thou, Bottom?
There are things in this comedy of Pyramus and Thisbe that will never please. First, Pyramus must draw a sword to kill himself, which ladies cannot abide. How do you answer to that? Not a witch. I devise it to make all. Write me a prologue, and let the prologue seek to say that we do no harm with our swords, and that Pyramus is not killed indeed. And for a better assurance, tell them that I, Pyramus, and not Pyramus, but Bottom the Weaver. This will put them out of fear.
You want the lady to be afeard of the lion?
I fear it, I promise you.
Masters, you ought to consider with yourselves to bring a god shield us. A lion, my lady, is the most dreadful thing.
Therefore, another prologue must tell that he is not a lion, but a man.
Nay, nay, you must name his name, and half his face must be seen through the mask, and he must speak through, saying thus, or to some effect, ladies, or fair ladies, I would request you not to fear, not to tremble. I'm a man as other men are. I let him then tell him plainly he is strong good joiner.
Then all is well, but there are two hard things in this play. First, there must be a way to bring the moonlight into the chamber, for we all know that Pyramus and Thisbe meet by moonlight.
Does the moon shine the night we play our play?
Aye, nay. Someone must come in with a bush of thorns and a lantern and say that he comes to present the personage of moonshine. Then there is the other thing. We must have a wall in the chamber, for it is also told that Pyramus and Thisbe speak through the chink in the wall.
You could never bring in a wall.
Nay, nay. Someone must present the wall, and let him have some loam, or some plaster, or some rough cast about them to signify the wall. And let him hold his fingers thus, and through that cranny shall Pyramus and Thisbe whisper.
Then all is well. Every mother's son. Sit down. Let us rehearse.
What hippin' homespuns have we a swaggering here, so near the cradle of the fairy queen?
I'll be an auditor. An actor too, perhaps, if I see commons.
Here, miss, speak up. Thisbe, stand forth.
Thisbe, thy flower's odors.
Odors.
Odors same as sweet, so hath thy dearest breath my Thisbe here.
A stranger peer must than ever presented here.
Oh, must I speak now?
Aye, you must, for you must understand that he goes but to see a noise that he heard, and is then to return again.
Most radiant Pyramus, most lily white.
Speak higher, you're gonna be a lady.
Most radiant Pyramus, most lily.
Higher.
Wait upon him and lead him to my bower.